The following program is a special presentation of the Big Ten Network, produced in association with Michigan State University.
Up next on MSU Today, MSU's role in the new bioeconomy.
We have some of the best plant scientists in the entire world here on this campus.
Spartan alums who are helping with America's favorite pastime.
My education is the basis for everything that I do here.
Getting young people out of the fields and into the classroom.
As I'm graduating, I say, boy, if I can graduate from a Big Ten university, I certainly can go to law school and obtain my JD, my law degree.
And a look inside Beaumont Tower. Hello and welcome to MSU Today. Over the next half hour and in future programs, we'll show you around and inside Michigan State University, from classroom action to the accomplishment of our alums to research that affects your daily life. Bioenergy, biofuels, bioeconomy. We all hear the words, we read about them, but do we really understand them? Cross-disciplinary research in these areas has set MSU at the forefront of this new era of creating tomorrow's biomass to biofuel pipeline and more. Recently, an announcement was made that Michigan State University will partner with the University of Wisconsin-Madison to create the Great Lakes Bioenergy Research Center to focus on these issues.
Today is another step on the journey to create a better future for Michigan and for the United States in a very competitive global environment.
The current crops that we grow were developed over more than 100 years for improved food production. But we now need new types of plants that have new traits that can be used for increased energy production.
These grasses that are right here are grasses that will be used for the research to put fuel into your tank.
This also represents a lot of work by a lot of people who believed that bioenergy, biomass, would be the solution for the future well before it was fashionable by any definition of a need for an energy alternative. But believing that through hard work and with our agricultural industries in the state and with our plant scientists, we could find this new future.
The new center will help researchers collaborate on the complex problems in converting natural materials to energy-producing products. It will build on the expertise of researchers here at MSU.
There's a critical mass of faculty and students here at MSU that are working on different aspects of the bioeconomy. If you look at the broad picture, basically what we've created here are a group of faculty and students with the expertise and the interest to explore all areas of taking biomass and converting it into different types of chemicals, pharmaceuticals, raw materials, and finished products that could have potentially very large benefits for a state such as Michigan.
We have some of the best plant scientists in the entire world here on this campus. And one of the things that the bioeconomy is neat for an engineer, it's an opportunity we chemical engineers have never had with raw materials. We've always been stuck with the raw materials that come out of the ground, the oil or the natural gas. Now we can have a raw material designed to kind of to suit our needs. It's a great potential.
In the future, Wisconsin, Michigan, and the Great Lakes region will become a main hub in providing the transitional science needed for new bioenergy breakthroughs. The research will assist in reducing our dependence on petroleum-based products.
Our fossil stores, the coal and natural gas and oil, those were actually derived from plant material very long time ago. We're using them up real fast, and Mother Nature isn't making them fast enough. So we have to find other sources for those same kinds of products, and we can do it with plants. Okay, we need to be more efficient, but the plants can provide us an awful lot of what we need.
There's a vision that's emerging that says that in the United States, there's the potential through biomass to create enough liquid fuel to replace as much as 30-40% of the petroleum that's now used.
In addition to creating new alternative fuels, researchers are also developing additional uses for agricultural products, from biodegradable packing materials to consumer goods.
Both cornstarch and vegetable oil serve as the platform for making products based entirely from petroleum. We came up with the concept that if we put food color into our materials and made what you have seen as peanut packaging, and it has the ability that if you wet it, it can stick together, we would have a construction kit out of starch foam. It sells in about 2,000, 3,000 stores in the United States. It's worldwide too.
It's rewarding in a sense to see that we've been able to do something that was leading the pack, so to speak, and provide us with an alternative material. But it's even more rewarding to see that people are seriously taking up the opportunity to use sustainable materials to replace conventional materials that they've been so used to using.
For the researchers, it's not only the development of new bioprocesses that drives them, but the continued generation of knowledge and ideas.
The whole reason why I still stay at the university and not just move into one of the companies I've created is the ability and the fun to work with these bright young minds. Not only do you want to develop the next generation of technologies for the value it creates in terms of jobs, in terms of the economy of the state, but also for training and nurturing and creating a whole new breed of entrepreneurial engineers who can transform and diversify the Michigan economy and the country's economy.
For me, it sort of brings the mission, the academic mission, full circle. You're not there until someone in the marketplace can pick up a product that began as a basic idea in an institution like this one.
The new center will be funded by the largest federal grant exclusively for research in Michigan State's history. Up next, we'll take a closer look at one of MSU's most enduring symbols. Every university has its landmarks, each one with its own history and special place in the hearts of alums. Here at MSU, there is nothing that says home like the bells of Beaumont Tower.
Built in 1928, the John W. Beaumont Memorial Tower rises over 100 feet above the sacred circle of the MSU campus. The tower stands as a testament to MSU's commitment to education. Beaumont Tower stands on what was the northeast corner of College Hall, not only the first instructional building to be erected on the MSU campus, but the first building in the United States to be devoted entirely to the teaching of scientific agriculture. Beaumont Tower marks the birthplace of the entire land-grant system.
I think it's just being here and the peace and serenity of it all. It just gives you a terrific feeling of sacredness and of beauty. I think that's pretty much it. It's a very relaxing time.
Residing within the tower is the carillon, a precision musical instrument with 49 finely tuned bells that allow complex musical compositions covering at least 2 octaves. The bells range from 15 pounds to over 2 tons and are played from a special keyboard that permits control of expression through variation of touch. Presently, there are 170 carillons across the United States, including 13 in Michigan. The tower's bells and mechanics were refurbished in 1996, requiring teams from 2 continents to restore and enhance the carillon to its current state. Since then, Spartans have enjoyed the hourly chimes and a special summer concert series. The benefactor of the summer carillon series is Dr. Milton Milder, himself an institution at MSU, in memory of his wife, Kathleen.
I first met her when somebody said, Milder knows German, you better check your translations. She had art books, books on music, books in the humanities, and I said to myself, this is a person I could live with.
The Milder Concert Series attracts artists from around the globe to perform for grateful audiences.
In 2000, so 7 years ago, I had the opportunity to play it for a while. So this is the second time I'm here. It's actually a pleasure to play this one. Combined the easy handling, and the sound of the bells.
Yeah, this instrument is for everybody. it's you, like piano, you can stay at home, yeah? And when you practice, nobody can hear. But this, if you practice or if you play, everybody can hear it.
Well, I think the setting is beautiful. It's outstanding.
I think it's relaxing. It's pretty out here. Pack a picnic dinner, meet my husband after work, and lay it all out and invite our friends.
What I like is when people come to me after concert and say they heard piece so-and-so on orchestra or piano, and they like it on the carillon as well.
It's the only time that children can run around and enjoy themselves and not be shushed because they cannot disturb the artist involved. And it's wonderful that families can relax and sit back and enjoy music as it should be enjoyed.
For more information on the carillon and future concert series, go to www.msu.edu and search carillon. Next up, we'll check in with MSU pioneers in the Turfgrass Management Program and learn how their research is helping not only Olympic and Major League venues, but local ones as well. Stay tuned. If you're like me, you've no doubt marveled at those pristine grass fields that athletes play on. At the Hancock Turfgrass Research Center here at Michigan State, instructors and students alike have been tackling the issues of turf management for years. When World Cup soccer came to Michigan, the organization turned to the experts at MSU for help. So how do you get an Olympic-quality grass field grown in a short period of time? Oh, and did I mention, it has to be mobile and indoors too. The concept was new, growing grass in modular systems that could then be moved indoors and installed on the event floor. An innovation at the time, it has now been reused at several sites around the globe.
A good example is both of these Olympics that we're working on here in Athens, Greece, and also the Beijing Olympics, is the opening ceremonies is really driving the need for modular turf. They want to have an opening ceremonies that's aquatic in nature or has a big hole in the stadium. And there's no way natural turf could survive that type of traffic and that type of situation. But if you've got a modular field that's outside waiting that can be moved in as soon as the opening ceremonies are over, in 48 hours you can have a world-class playing surface.
But what the team has learned from these experiences can now be transferred to other uses, including the local high school.
What's been interesting for us is the ability to transfer the knowledge from the big projects to the small projects. So while we were doing million-dollar projects like the Silver Dome and Spartan Stadium in Athens, Greece, what we were learning from those projects actually are benefiting now the high schools in Michigan and even the high schools in all of the Midwest.
Dr. Rogers and his graduate students are working on ways to perfect their root zone application process. The special root zone is a mixture of sand and clay that is distributed across a playing field to strengthen existing growth. Combined with proper drainage, such a process can increase the seasonal availability of the field and withstand additional wear.
Anything that had been built with this root zone held up dramatically well. And so the idea had to become, how can we get this root zone on as many high school fields as cheaply as possible?
Dr. Rogers credits a lot of the past work and future success of the center to the caliber of the students in the program.
I guess if you had to ask where our alums are, I think we're in every state in the United States. We're in about 20 countries around the world, running golf courses, running stadiums.
One such alum is Heather Nabosny, currently with the Detroit Tigers. She is the first woman to serve as head groundskeeper in Major League Baseball. It was her education at MSU that led her to this Major League ballpark.
My education is the basis for everything that I do here. Michigan State helped me get my first professional baseball job, which was down in Florida in Dunedin. That definitely was my goal, to be a Major League groundskeeper. It's a you don't think it's ever going to happen because there's only 30 jobs in the United States, and to be holding one of the jobs is, I'm lucky, lucky, lucky. Faculty are wonderful. They are still helping me today. I had a problem a couple weeks ago with, I had to call the entomology department, and Dr. Smitley helped me out a lot. One of his research assistants actually came out and worked with me for a day.
MSU's turf grass visionaries and pioneers, combining science and hard work.
We've always kind of go into it with the idea that, well, you might not understand there's a lot of science to it now, but you will by the time we're finished. But it's still kind of funny because at the end of the day, it is just grass.
Just grass. If only my lawn could look that good. For more information on the Turfgrass Research Center, log on to the main MSU website and search for Turfgrass. Up next, opening a door of opportunity for students who thought they'd never go to college. Stick around. Innovation and access have long been two staples of MSU's legacy, and today nothing defines that better than MSU Camp. The College Assistance Migrant Program gives the children of migrant farm workers the choice they thought they'd never have.
3/4 of the students that we bring in from our program would not be at a college or a university anywhere.
Begun in 2000, the program helps students adjust to their first year of college and provides a support system to assist with crucial study and time management skills and to encourage them to finish their degree.
History has shown us if we can, that student can make it through that first year, there increases the likelihood of they will continue on through their 4-year experience.
I come from being a migrant worker, from working in the fields, from picking the cherries and asparagus and this, and now I'm walking through a Big Ten university that is recognized nationally. And as I'm graduating, I say, well, if I could graduate from a Big Ten university, I certainly can go to law school and obtain my JD, my law degree.
I got some insight into the folks behind the program with Luis and President Simon and their team. They put a very creative, effective program in place that's unique to this country. And we need to applaud them for that.
Camp is funded by the U.S. Department of Education, but it has found other benefactors who see the value in such programs.
If we're going to survive in the type of America that will take place in the next few years, we have to have folks who are bilingual, bicultural, and have numerous experience that would allow us to enter and maintain these new marketplaces.
So our kids, I think, bring a diversity of experiences that they've had themselves and incorporate it into what they're going to have here. It just makes them, I think, more marketable and more flexible to operate within anywhere in the country.
When we see a program like CAMP, which is clearly working, where we have an opportunity to come, meet with the students, hear their story, it's pretty much a no-brainer for us.
By seeing a corporation giving money to the program, it says to me that they're investing. They're investing in the future, and they're investing in students, and they're making a good investment.
For migrant families, child-parent separation is the first hurdle, and the program works closely with local schools to sponsor visits to MSU that open new possibilities to the potential students.
At different points in time throughout the year, we have sophomores, juniors, and seniors to come and visit Michigan State University. To some of these kids, they had never been to a university.
I was just so proud of them to see how interested they were and how their brains, I could just see their brains working 100 miles per hour because they were thinking, wow, there's a job out there in packaging. The mind was just so closed into certain types of jobs. And I said, look at this, there's an array of jobs, and he's asking a question. That excited me.
When they see our other migrant students here, they quickly identify with the faces and say, wait a minute, if he or she can make it, I can make it.
My dreams, I guess, or my expectations of myself have changed tremendously. And now I realize that not only can I graduate from college, but I can also go above and beyond that.
These aren't abstract metrics that we are looking at in a report that somebody sends us. It's nice to get that kind of data on the success of a program, but it isn't the same thing as hearing the beneficiaries themselves tell us their own personal view of what this program meant to them to be able to come to MSU.
It's a matter of giving those folks an opportunity that they might not ordinarily have, and that's what the CAMP program's all about.
The College Assistance Migrant Program truly embodies MSU's focus on advancing knowledge and transforming lives. For more information about CAMP, log on to msu.edu and search for MSU CAMP. Well, that's all for this edition of MSU Today. We hope we have given you a glimpse of life around and inside Michigan State University. You can search the main msu.edu website for additional information on these stories. If you have any comments for us, please email us at comments@ur.msu.edu. Again, thanks for watching MSU Today, and remember, go green!
The preceding program was produced by Michigan State University in association with the Big Ten Network.